Random House Audio presents Law of the Desert Born, a dramatization of the short story by Louis L'Amour.
Bowman?
What the hell are you doing here?
He died, Judd.
It was midday in Puerto de Luna, and the town was quiet in the afternoon heat. Harvey Bristol tipped back in his chair outside the general store, while down the street at the jailhouse, Marvin Hanley was fixing the prisoner's lunch. Joe Potts, the undertaker, walked slowly down the dusty street towards home. He had been up all night working on a new coffin. At the blacksmith's, Ben White from the Bar B chewed on a piece of straw while he watched the Mexican hammer out shoes for his mare. He glanced up and saw the sheriff driving a wagon down the dusty street. Taylor, another hand from the Bar B, was with him. A form wrapped in a dusty sheet lay in the wagon bed.
Huh, what do you know?
Hey, Sheriff, what's happened?
You better come over to the jailhouse, Ben. Your boss has been killed.
What?
It happened about an hour ago.
Was it Marone?
¿Qué pasa?
You too, Martine. I'm gonna need some help.
Judd Bowman's been killed.
Madre de Dios.
Over at the jail, Marvin was giving the prisoner his lunch when he heard the wagon pull up outside.
Here you go, son.
Gracias.
Ben, come on and help me get him out of the sun.
It was Marone, wasn't it?
Sure was. I saw him right away myself.
Here, son, take his legs.
We going after?
Oh, we have to. Marvin, go find Potts and tell him we've got another job for him.
Hey, Sheriff! I can help you to find Marone.
You're in enough trouble as it is, Lopez.
Isn't that right, Sheriff?
Go wake up Harvey and get us some provisions, okay, Ben?
Sure thing.
And get some extra canteens. Taylor, get some ammunition from that safe and pull out the makings for my sharps. See if you can find my binoculars while you're at it.
I can help!
Don't try my patience, Lopez.
Here you go.
What about Patterson?
At the Bar B? What about him?
Well, he's pretty good at reading sign, isn't he?
Yes, sir, but I think Mrs. Bowman's gonna want him around to help with Judd and everything.
Well, how about Henry Burns?
His eyes aren't as good as they used to be, Sheriff.
My mother was an Apache. Tracking is in my blood.
Oh, hell. Just a second. I can't let you out, Lopez. You know that.
I got the supplies.
I know, Marone. I know how he thinks. I can read his mind as well as his trail.
What's going on?
Lopez wants to go after Marone.
You're not going anywhere, half-breed.
It's not up to you. To catch Marone, you need a tracker, and I can do it.
This guy stole our cattle. You believe what he's saying?
Well, we might have no other choice.
He is in the land of my people, Sheriff. I am more useful to you out there than in here.
Well, all right. But listen, you'd be handcuffed at all times.
Great.
You'd have no food or water on your own, and of course we won't let you carry a gun.
I will not let you down.
If you're lying to us about your skills, you're back in jail immediately.
The only skill he has is rustling cattle.
And if there's any trouble, you can be sure it'll go into my report to the circuit judge.
There will be no trouble.
Hold out your arms.
Gracias, Sheriff.
This is not a favor.
Shad Marone rode hard for almost 2 days, following the Pecos River as it twisted south towards Texas. There would be a posse after him, of course. You can't kill someone like Judd Bowman and just be allowed to get away. But he'd chosen the Pecos because it was difficult, and he rode in the water or along the rocky banks when he could. From time to time, he left the river and picked it up further on, confusing his trail as much as possible while still moving quickly. Even if they were able to track him, He figured after a couple of days of rough terrain, they'd be strongly inclined to give up. He planned on heading straight down into Texas. If they were fool enough to follow him there, he'd keep going until he reached Mexico. If they followed him that far, they were crazier than he thought. Even Judd Bowman wasn't worth Mexico. At dusk on the second day, he scrambled to the top of a steep riverbank and looked back to see if anyone was behind him. The land was peaceful and still, and the leaves on the trees shimmered brightly in the setting sun. But something nagged at him, and he stared at the valley to the north for a long time. He couldn't see anything, but he didn't feel safe either. Miles upriver, Lopez rode, leaning out from his saddle, studying the riverbed intently.
Well?
Whoa! He was here 4 hours ago.
How can you be sure?
Despite his manacled hands, Lopez slid out of the saddle easily and pointed to some plants growing by the river.
His horse broke the branches there. And here is where he stepped to avoid the rocks. His print in the wet sand is not yet completely washed out, so it cannot be too old.
I can't see anything in this light.
If he's so close, maybe we can still catch up.
Ay, que idiota.
What did you say?
He said it is not wise to track a murderer in the dark.
Save your steam, boys. We've still got a long way to go.
The men set up camp on a sandy bluff overlooking the valley. They had ridden a rough 25 miles, and they were exhausted and sore. Lopez was given food and water, but his handcuffs were not removed, nor was he allowed near anyone's rifle. Even after the sun had set, he stood looking south as the coyotes began to howl at each other across the desert. Only when the other men had settled did he lie down and go to sleep himself. Lopez rose before dawn and rekindled the fire. While the coffee was heating, the sheriff woke up.
Don't you sleep, Lopez? Come on, rise and shine, boys.
Martin got up and went to saddle the horses as the other men drank their coffee in silence. Lopez watched them and realized it had been a long time since Taylor or the sheriff had ridden so hard.
Someone pack up Lopez's gear and let's go.
If you take these cuffs off, I can help.
Not a chance, amigo.
You get the fire.
Lopez began kicking sand over the hot embers, then stopped and looked sideways at the other men. They had already mounted and were starting off down the hill. Lopez quickly found some green manzanita leaves and dropped them on the remaining coals.
Come on, Lopez. I want to get this over with today.
Lopez mounted his horse and rode quickly after the men. Behind him, the leaves began to burn. Downriver, Shad Marone was also starting the day. He had slept soundly and was feeling good as he surveyed the land around him, until he saw a thin line of black smoke curling up against the horizon.
Well, I'll be.
It was about 5 miles north, and he couldn't afford to believe it was a coincidence. He had to assume he was being followed, and they were too close for comfort. He shook his head slowly. It was careless of them to leave smoke that could be seen from miles around. But they had tracked him closely for 2 days over rough territory. Whoever was following his sign knew what they were doing. Shad had hoped to stay close to the river, but now he considered changing his plans. If they insisted upon following him, he wasn't going to make it easy. Texas would have to wait. The desert to the west was a vast no-man's land of mesas, salt marshes, and lava fields. Shad had crossed it several times with Navajo guides, and he did not underestimate the treachery of the terrain. By day, the heat was relentless, and the cold was bitter at night. The howling wind blew the red sand over tracks as fast as a horse could make them. Unless his pursuers knew how to find water, they'd soon have more problems than simply bringing him back to justice. He turned west, following a stream through the steep cliffs of the Yeso Canyon until it disappeared into the craggy mesas beyond. Finally, he found a trail, and as Morgan scrambled up to the bluffs overlooking the river.
Come on.
Urging the horse into a gallop, Marone headed back the way he had come. The smoke he had seen made him suspect.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.